Welcome back to the Star Wars Show. Today we are joined by a good friend of mine, Dave Filoni. How's it going?
Good. I've never been on this show like this before with the couch situation and the whole...
Right?
I don't usually get this. I get like a little podium I can pop behind. And you, yeah, I guess.
We're legit.
It's taken a while, though, to get invited on, which is because I'm right next door, which is strange.
Yeah.
I would have thought maybe sooner, but you know... I guess you wanted to iron out your process first.
We had to, you know, do you the courtesy of actually inviting you in, instead of just annoying.
Is that right? Well, we'll see. We might combine those things into one today. So, what would you like to discuss?
So, I mean, we've had you on before to talk about Rebels. We've been talking about Rebels on Rebels Recon together for 2 years.
It's been a while. Is it two?
2 years, two seasons.
I don't even know. It all blends together.
Yeah. But, today I want to talk about Dave Filoni. I want to talk about you. Let's get
Why?
To the heart of
Why
this.
Why do we want to talk about that?
Because you're an interesting guy.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
You should bring my wife on this show.
Oh, no, that would be dangerous.
And then you could ask her about me.
And you could just sit in between
that
us.
That would be better.
That would be cool.
No, I wouldn't be here. I would be gone, and you just interview her. That she's vastly more interesting, so.
You've been making amazing animation, doing amazing Star Wars animation for over a decade now.
It sounds old, but it's true.
You've had an incredible history here, but I'm curious about how you started off with Star Wars, because I know you've been a fan for pretty much your entire life.
Yeah, there was no being a fan when I was a kid. You were just a kid, and we were lucky enough to grow up with Star Wars. So it wasn't something that you thought about.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't even think of it being incredibly lucky. You just go, my gosh, there's this amazing story, this film. And there was nothing like it. Like, I can't even describe how different it was, how unique it was in every, you know, aspect of its creation, the characters, the way the effects were. I mean, everything just stuck with you. So we weren't fans. We were just living it. We were just kids growing up in a Star Wars era. And you see how it's affected people throughout the industry, throughout the world, you know, like in Celebration London, you meet people from all over, and it's kind of this neat shared experience that people have, and they keep trying to experience it over and over again. But I mean, so starting with Star Wars, it's just being a kid, and like I remember big moments that never happened with anything else, where my dad brought home Star Wars figures, and it wasn't my birthday, it wasn't Christmas, it was just the middle of the week, and he brought home Star Wars figures, and we didn't even know that there were like really action figures like this. They were kind of the first of their kind for my brother and I, and he brought these action figures home, and it was just mind-blowing, you know, and you're like the packaging. All of that stuff is so significant to the generation that had it, that you keep seeing it reissued, and it's a big deal. So that's kind of, we had the full experience, the music, the records, we just played the heck out of because we didn't have it. You know, you couldn't rewatch Star Wars. We couldn't download it, for God's sakes.
Right.
Couldn't even own it on VHS. You had to listen to the music, and sometimes you'd have like the story on record. And I think that's why, while the John Williams music is so brilliant, but it's also the way we learned the story by listening to the music, because that's what we had, and the music tells the story so clearly. So all of that is just unique to its time, I think, and made a huge impression, obviously. And movies of its type, and you could always kind of feel the same aspiration, the same hope, the sense of wonder.
Mm-hmm.
Star Wars has it. Steven Spielberg films have this sense of wonder, which now is kind of it's almost in some ways lost, I feel. While movies are now trying to impress us with big explosions and big effects and really intense plots. But the sense of wonder that like a movie like E.T. has, you know, that Goonies has a sense of wonder to it as these kids are exploring their world and realizing there's much more magic to it. And that's something that I'm always very interested in. And it's very difficult to do, which is why I think people either try to do it and fail or just don't try to do it at all. But we grew up in a period where there were a lot of those movies, and that was kind of the going way. I think as these films like Star Wars and E.T., Close Encounters, all came out of a filmmaking generation that were telling incredible tales. You know, you had Apocalypse Now, you had The Godfather, you had movies like, you know, The Shining. You had just incredible films. So there was a lot to live up to, even for a blockbuster. So that's kind of like, you know, when I was a kid, my dad was showing me Kurosawa films when I was like 10.
Right.
Because those movies were important to him. So we watched The Seventh Seal. We watched The Seven Samurai. We watched, you know, Battleship Potemkin. Like, and I'm just 10 years old and I didn't always understand what was going on.
So you were, but, I mean, you were being kind of ingrained with like really complex emotional mental storytelling from a really young age.
Yeah, well, because my parents were both like artists of their own type. My father's an architect and my mother was a musician and a singer, and my father and her were both involved with Pittsburgh opera. So opera and things of that nature and storytelling, like Wagnerian things and Ring cycles, were commonplace in my house. Mm-hmm. You know, he flew us as kids to New York to watch Leonard Bernstein conduct because he felt it was important to see this man and his talent conducting. And so those things were just prevalent in my life. And we had a Betamax, you know, a Beta player, which was great. And we had all these films on Betamax to watch. And I remember, I think Alexander Nevsky and definitely, I don't know if we had Seven Samurai and Beta, but we definitely had Bergman films that we would watch on Betamax. And I had actually I had Godzilla movies on Beta.
Of course you did.
Well, I love these, you know, these big films. And it's just, you know, every person in film lists all these same movies. But I love Godzilla movies.
I know. Every time you go into your office, it's just like,
oh my gosh. I had Godzilla vs. Mothra on Beta, Monster Zero on Beta, all on Beta, Megalon on Beta. Like, Terror of Mechagodzilla. I used to wear those tapes out. And oddly, a bunch of Star Trek films, which we loved. Like, we had Star Trek 1 through 4 all on Beta. Just fantastic.
Turn the cameras off. I love Star Trek.
Of course. I mean,
Star Trek 4 is one of my favorite movies.
You will be hard-pressed to have a story meeting on Rebels without somebody bringing up Wrath of Khan. It comes up, like, almost every story meeting. So these are the kind of big influences over the years. And we just watched them relentlessly and so, but that sense of wonder and that's the biggest thing that I like about movies. I was just watching today, I don't know if you know the film Empire of the Sun, but it's a Steven Spielberg and Kathy Kennedy produced film, and it's just fantastic. The moments in it, the emotional impact, and at times it's Christian Bale in his first role as a little kid.
He was young, yeah. Yeah. Before
little,
Newsies?
Yeah? Little kid. Okay. Yeah, I think so. I think before. And he's just phenomenal in it. It's so amazing to watch him and the emotional range that he'll get in one scene. And so those are the things I watch even when I'm trying to be inspired to do Rebels or Clone Wars. I never actually watch Star Wars to get inspired to do anything in Star Wars. Never.
You know it.
It's not so much that, I think, is like, it's something George used to talk about, like just not being in universe. You're telling these stories in universe, you start to narrow who actually understands what you're talking about. And the beauty of Star Wars is how it always appeals to everybody. Whether you're a huge fan and you know the details of it or not, it just connects with you. And, you know, so I'm more likely like if I'm driving to work and I want to get excited about, not that I need to get excited because I love what I do every day, but to get in the mood, sometimes I'll listen to some 50s music, you know, early 60s music, American Graffiti style stuff. I'll listen to some classical music if I'm doing something more emotional, like Ahsoka Vader. But that's what I get into. Not even the Star Wars stuff. I guess I do know it, but you want to do something new. You want to add something to the vocabulary.
Right. And I think we'll circle back to that in a minute. But I want to get back to, when did animation come into your realm? Like, how did you kind of set that out as your path?
Well, again, like just being lucky with the time period I grew up in, you know, Saturday morning cartoons were a big deal. Like we all loved them and would watch them like somewhat religiously. And there were always animated shows that made an impact, and I've gone over them in the past. But Dungeons and Dragons is a TV series, and Saturday morning blew my mind. It was incredibly powerful to me as a young kid, seeing these kids go on this journey in this magical dimension, and it would get kind of serious at times, but still be, you know, hopeful at the end. And Robotech was a game changer for me because of the characters and the soap opera of it. And yeah, just even no animation could do that stuff. And then a little bit older, we watched Akira. And Akira is like a, you watch it and then we immediately watched it again because we're like, what in the world? You know, we knew something big was going on, but we didn't even quite understand it. So we kids watched it twice. So I started to learn that there was this amazing art form. And then Fantasia was a big impact because I'm like, here's the music like my dad listens to all the time. And it's being crossed with imagery.
Right.
You know, and I loved moving pictures and music. And that reminded me of Star Wars as well, the moving picture and the music. And it was also connected. So when I was in high school taking art classes, my teacher, Dave Schenefeld, he took us down to meet an actual artist working in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So you're in high school and you go take a field trip that day to meet an actual artist. And this guy who did these amazing paintings. And really impressive, you know, kind of somewhat abstract, but all urban city kind of stuff. And I don't know what possessed me, but I just asked him, I said, so what do you do if you're not selling paintings? Because I was kind of like a junior in high school going on to senior and was trying to figure out, well, what am I going to do with my life? And I like art, I like painting, and but I'm concerned about that. Like, how is that a life? How is that a job? So I asked this guy, and he said, oh, I'd pump gas. And I was like, what? What do you mean? He's like, yeah, well, you know, I got to eat. So if I don't sell paintings, I have a job and I pump gas. And it was very honest, very direct. Coming from Pittsburgh, a coal mining city, and my having grandparents that worked in a coal mine and worked for the railroads, and an uncle that worked in the steel mills. You're like, yeah, all right, that makes a lot of sense to me. So how am I going to make that work? Because that was kind of stressful. I was like, you know, in life, you kind of want consistency and you want to kind of know what you're going to be doing and how to handle it. So I started to think, well, animation works in a studio. That seems to be like a job that has a structure to it, maybe like Walt Disney or something. So that was one of the things that started to push me into animation. I'll be very honest. I've never been a person that like would say, I love without fail animation. I don't know everything about it. I can't quote you all the great nine old men from Walt Disney. I don't know them all. I don't know those things. There are people that know that stuff, that are into that stuff. I like telling stories and I can draw. So there seemed to be a natural connection I will start to do animation, but nothing that I animated in college, when I finally went to Edinburgh University in Pennsylvania, it would strike you as anything that's Disney-esque. Mm-hmm. It's not roundy, boundy. It doesn't follow a lot of the rules.
I mean, you can say that about like Avatar, like working on The Last Airbender is very different from what you've been doing with Star Wars. And that, I mean,
it's more similar though than not, I would say, Airbender. But Airbender is able to be funnier and more over the top and goofy than we would ever be, frankly, allowed to be by the fan base. The fan base of Star Wars wouldn't accept some of the crazy cabbage people from Airbender and some of the over-top nature and contemporary vibe that show has. But that show was wonderful in that it kind of was the first time I got to do anything in the industry that was remotely close to what I liked. Mm-hmm. You know, you get a job in animation and then you're going to work. You know, I studied Caravaggio painting and emulated his style in college as a study and studied all these other fine arts. And then I get my first job and I was working on King of the Hill drawing, you know, four guys drinking beer next to a
fence
in Texas.
Really? You worked on King of the Hill? I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
No.
My first like big job was working as a layout artist in King of the Hill. And I have to say, I loved it. It was a great experience. And some of the most talented people I've ever worked with were on King of the Hill, without a doubt. What I learned on King of the Hill at Film Roman has served me my entire career. But for my dad, while he was always proud of me, he was like, you know, I think it was hard, not hard, but it's interesting for him to see, like, I spent all that time in art school doing all these fine art things, and now I'm drawing four guys drinking beer on a fence, you know. And they all thought it was funny, but, you know, its style isn't as such that you would think, this is great art, but it is. Like, if you see the work that goes into a show like that, any animated show, while the end result is a style that's intentionally kind of wonky looking and rough. There's a lot of study that goes into all of that. And I don't know that the teams that work on those shows ever kind of get that respect or credit from the art world. But, you know, on King of the Hill, I was able to do layout. I was able to assist and direct. I was able to do timing, learn about design, talk to background artists. Like, I was able to do a whole bunch of things that had I been an in-betweener, I never would have made it or known about those jobs. So when you go to school for animation, you think I'm going to be an animator. And I talk to people, I said, what are you? Well, I'm an animator. I'm like, no, you're not. You're not an animator. You're a background artist. You're a layout artist. You're a timer. Like, animation is a technique. It's a discipline. It's something that you do. It's a craft where they make motion, the motion of life. And that's a very specific task within a genre called animation, right? But I have known very few animators that are like full-on animators. We tend to be a lot of multitaskers.
Right.
Like, I'm an okay animator at best. I want to say that I'm very good. I know some fantastic animators that are just brilliant that I wouldn't even go near because they're so great. So my skills I learned out of school wasn't that like, oh, what I like about this field isn't animating. I like telling the story. So I had to kind of figure that out while I was on the job, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. And not enough students, these schools teach you, you know, kind of,
they give you're going to be an like
animator,
the...
but it's not very helpful.
Exactly.
Because it's not what I'm looking for when I'm trying to hire people, you know. So that was kind of an awakening when you get out into the business world and how that business of animation works. There were a ton of people on that show that were hugely influential, and like, you know, Lauren McMullen, who is a fantastic director. She did the animated Mickey short that was before Frozen.
Okay.
Where he breaks the plane and comes out into the world, and it's all kind of rubber steam, you know, hose kind of animation.
Yeah, and, like really old school, like Steamboat Willie style.
Yeah, that style short that was before that movie she did. And it was, so I was lucky to learn from people like her and guys like Joe Horn and Vince Waller, who, you know, who Joe Horn was with Liquid Television Animation in its very early days on MTV and did a lot of, I think The Specialist was his animation, and he did, I worked with him on a series called The Oblongs. And then Vince Waller, who I was with on The Oblongs, right? He was a Ren and Stimpy guy. I had never met guys like that before. And they're not just brilliant and super talented. They're, you know, incredibly well-educated, really know what they're talking about. So I followed them from Film Roman actually to Disney. So then I worked at Walt Disney Pictures.
That lays an incredible foundation.
I guess, yeah.
So tell me about how, you know, you got involved with Lucasfilm and came to, you know, the Clone Wars.
Yeah, that was all bizarre. I went from Disney to Nickelodeon because friends of mine that I worked with at Film Roman, Mike and Brian, where they had created Avatar The Last Airbender, and they called me and said, we'd like you to come over and direct this thing. And I said, okay, what is it? I went and saw it, and I was just like, I remember thinking when I watched the pilot to Airbender that my thought was they did it. Like, Mike and Brian had convinced somebody in the Institution of American Animation to make a show that had everything that I thought was important about what anime was about, what just that kind of wonder was about. They nailed it. I thought the show was so great. And I was like, I'm absolutely going to go and do this. And in fact, I convinced them to let me direct the whole first hour of it because I was so excited about doing it. And so I was on Airbender, and it was just the greatest experience. I worked with a lot of friends of mine, from Mike and Brian to Giancarlo. You know, Lauren also mm-hmm. worked on it as a director. My buddy Anthony that I knew on King of the Hill was there. So it was a bunch of us. It was such a great environment because we were all working hard on this show because our friends created it. It's just a great environment to be in. So while we're on this show, Revenge of the Sith is in its build-up. And Giancarlo worked on Clone Wars with me later. I brought him up. Mm-hmm. We were completely fanboying out on everything happening, and we were so excited. And, you know, you get some of the prequel haters, and we're just like, whatever, we don't care about you. You don't know what you're talking about. And so we're talking about this stuff, and we've got our lightsabers, and we're building a Kif Fisto and a Plo Koon mask in my garage. So we're having a great time. And then Our buddy Chris Panosky was working on the opening titles to Airbender, you know, which you know well.
I've seen them.
Right. And Chris, you know, he didn't really get the prequels. So I would say, look, Chris, you're looking at this all the wrong way. Let me explain to you how to look at these movies. And if you think about this and when Anakin's doing this and think about these things, now go watch the movie. And he would go and watch it. And he came back. He's like, my gosh, that was way better than I thought. Tell me about the next one. I'm like, okay, but you think about these things in Attack of the Clones. So I would give him these kind of briefs on what was important about the prequels and how he should be open-minded to looking at things as opposed to like the way he wanted things to have been. And that really made an impression on him. And he got a call out of the blue from you know, a guy that was saying Lucasfilm is hiring for their animated series, Clone Wars. Do you know anybody that could direct it? And Chris was like, Dave Filoni. And they're like, okay, well, anybody else? He's like, no, that's the guy you want. But I didn't know that, and he never told me that happened. So meanwhile, cut to Giancarlo and I with our lightsabers at Nickelodeon Studios hanging out. And Giancarlo's like, you know, Filoni, what would you do? You know, what would get you off of this show, Airbender? It's such a fun show. What would it take? I'm like, if George Lucas called and offered me a job, I'd go. And here and I'm like, it's never going to happen. But that's funny, you know, it's funny because it's Star Wars, you know.
Yeah.
So a week later, I get this phone call and I answer it. And it's this woman, Catherine Winder, and she's a producer for Lucasfilm Animation. And I'm thinking like, yeah, there's no Lucasfilm Animation. What is this? And she's like, we're hiring, we want to interview for supervising director of Clone Wars TV series. I'm like, really? Didn't you just do that? Lucasfilm Animation from over there, Cartoon Network. And she's like, well, this isn't 2D. This is going to be CG. And I'm like, yeah, I don't do CG. I'm a 2D guy. Like, what are you talking about? So I'm immediately thinking, like, this is the SpongeBob guys. This is the guys right around the corner.
They're
and they're just
you?
Messing with me because they are very funny. It's what they do. They're funny all day. And I'm thinking, this is mean. They're really sick of Giancarlo and I, like, talking about Star Wars. So they're setting me up.
Did you say no?
So I'm on the phone, but I decided to go along with it, right? Because it's just my nature. And she's like, well, I would like to meet you and talk with you about this. I'm like, oh, I would love to meet you, Catherine. Where would you like to meet? But I don't want to be taken in, you know? So I'm trying to be, like, all strong about it.
Right.
And we arranged the time and stuff. And she's like, okay, well, I guess I'll see you there. And I said, okay. And I said, look, I have to ask you a question. And she's like, all right. I said, who is this really? And she's like, excuse me? I'm like, is this the guys around the corner? Because this is just, it's kind of mean. And she's like, is this Dave Filoni? I'm like, yeah. And she's like, do you work on Airbender? I'm like, yeah. And she's like, well, you're the guy. And I'm thinking like, oh, wait a minute. This suddenly this sounds real. Really real. And then my answer was like, oh, you have no idea how the guy I am. I am so the guy. I have a Plo Koon costume in my garage.
Like, let's do this
now
right
I'm
now.
Saying all the wrong things, like absolutely the wrong things. And later, Catherine told me she wanted to like cancel the interview right there, but she had already said it because she's like, you sound like a crazy person. But then I went and met her and that went great. And, you know, I was able to show her my work and we discussed what it was going to be. And then I met Gail Curry, who was VP of Lucasfilm Animation at the time. And to get the job, I had to fly up and meet George Lucas. So the first time I was really ever on Skywalker Ranch, I flew up, which was a total catastrophe. The plane was like over an hour late. We're driving across the Richmond Bridge and something smashed through the car roof window, that the sunroof that was taking me to the ranch.
Wow.
And I was like, okay, this is weird.
This is fate.
This is like a sign that I should not be taking this job. And then I went to the ranch and I saw the main house. I'm like, wow, I'd only seen this in a video. And my whole ambition was just to interview. I just wanted to meet George, so when I was in line at Revenge of the Sith, I can say, yeah, well, I met George Lucas, how cool is that? Because I'm like, there's no way I'm going to get this job, because I felt like immensely underqualified for the job, because I didn't do CG animation. I had only directed 1 year of Airbender. It was the first time I'd really directed anything. So I was like, but it's cool, at least I'm going to get to meet George, and then he's worked with some of the greatest artists ever in the industry, and I will be like summarily turned away. But it's
right?
Neat. Well, it's just neat to say I met George Lucas, right? So I go in and I meet him, and we talk for about 20 minutes. It's a 20-minute meeting. I walked in his office, you know, in the main house, and I was like, you know, just looking at everything.
Can I sit? Like, did you touch anything?
It was amazing. I didn't really, no. I mean, I just, I kind of just zened myself over to the table where we sat down and talked, and he looked at my portfolio, and he kind of went through it like this. You know, we looked at things briefly, and I thought, yeah, this is what I thought. Like, this guy's not, you're not going to impress him with your art. Come on. And then he shut it, and he goes, well, this is what a Jedi Knight is. And he just starts talking to me about Star Wars and Jedi and stuff. And I was like, okay, that's cool. And I remember thinking, like, yeah, I totally got what he's saying exactly from the movies. And it was fun because some of it was, like, stuff I'd debated with friends of mine about how the Force worked and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, okay. So.
And it's just, like, confirming
so
everything
I was right. This is cool. But I was very quiet, and I didn't say a lot. And, you know, we just spoke briefly for, like, kind of what the Clone Wars was about and Jedi and how the Force worked. And, you know, fun listening to him. He's very nice. And then just remembering my manners when the time was over, I got up and I thought, well, I'm never going to see this guy again. So I shook his hand. I said, it was very nice to meet you. And he said, very nice to meet you. And I went back to the green room. And I felt this great sense of relief because I was like, all right, well, I don't have to, like, that's over. And that was cool. And you know what? He was a really nice guy, which is great because I really like his work.
Yeah.
And you never know when you meet people. So I thought it's great. He was really nice. And that was over. And then the door opens and Catherine sticks her head in and says, he likes you. You got the job. And I was like, what? And then she shut the door. And I remember my first thought was like, oh, my gosh, these people have no idea what they're doing. Like, I thought, like, you're going to hire me for this job? You're crazy. And in my mind, I hadn't accepted the job. But in their mind, it was a done deal.
Right. They offer it. And you can't even. There's no option.
They
offer it and it happens.
We're walking out of the main house and they're introduced. This is Dave. He's going to direct Clone Wars. And people are like, oh, what's it going to be like? I'm like, I really don't know yet. This is just happening. And I remember flying home and we had a big dinner where Giancarlo came out, a couple friends, and Anne, and we were all there, and they were all so excited, and I was just sitting at the end of the table like, I'm gonna have to move. Like, my entire life had just changed, and I was not prepared for it at all. We were gonna have to move. You know, we loved our apartment. We had to give all that up. So it was crazy. But that was basically how it happened. And I found out later it was because Chris had recommended me. So it's really all his fault. And there's funny stuff I could give you guys. I don't know. It would probably be a mistake to give you. But when Revenge of the Sith came out, Giancarlo and I had finished our Plo Koon and Kefisto costumes.
I need to see these. There are pictures,
well,
right?
There's not just the pictures.
Oh.
There's a video.
Are you guys...
This is probably bad to say, everybody. But,
no, this is great.
But
this is
Kevin
great.
Yost, who cuts...
Yes, your trailers.
My trailers.
Yeah.
Well, Kevin, great friend of mine from back in L.A., when we had our costumes, we went around to the local theaters, and Kevin filmed us. And I had like 100... Star Wars action figures that I wasn't going to take with me to work up here. And I thought, well, I'm going to work on Star Wars now, so I don't really need these anymore. And so we went around as Kit Fisto and Plo Koon and found all these kids in line waiting for the movie, and we just handed them out to kids.
That's incredible.
Just handed them out. And so we have that all on film. Anne had her hair done up like Leia. And so we went to the Burbank AMC. We went to Nickelodeon Studios. We went to Burbank AMC, and then we went down to the Arclight. And what's interesting is that at the time of capturing all that footage, I've gone back and looked at it. And many of the people that I met there that night that were having fun and dressed up as characters are people that I have since met again.
That's what was going to be my question. Like,
that
has
are
anybody
fans of the show? Absolutely.
Been like, hey, you gave me this.
One, no, I've never had that happen. But like, I also went to Comic-Con that year as Plo Koon, even though I already had a job at Lucasfilm. But I'm like, come on, this is too fun. And one friend of mine has a picture of me and him when we didn't really know each other at Comic-Con, and I'm Plo Koon. So that's kind of like a funny thing. But there was a girl there dressed as Aayla Secura. And so, of course, so she was with me and Kit Fisto. And we're hanging out. And she had come from a panel that was a Lucasfilm panel. And we weren't on a panel yet because I hadn't even started making the show yet. And she was like, I hear they're going to make a new Clone Wars show. And she's telling me, like, I don't know. And I'm like, And she's like, oh, I hope the guys that are making it know what they're doing. And I'm like, well, I hope so. I hope they hired good people to do it. Like, what am I going to say? And I'm like,
like, I heard the guy that's literally making it's really, really good.
I didn't say that, you know, but I was like, a lot of funny things, you know, but yeah, that's the odd way that I got involved, so, you know, luck and being in the right place, right time, and then doing something once you have the opportunity is the key.
So then what was it like, because you've been a huge, I mean, you were obviously a huge Star Wars fan, a big George Lucas fan. Mm. I know, I mean, he's influenced you as a director, but what was it like going from a fan to being a peer of George Lucas? Because he's an awesome dude. Yeah. He's so smart, but he's a little intimidating.
Of
like,
course,
how do you
yeah.
make that jump?
You just have to decide that that's what you're going to do. You know, it's like, I was really lucky in that, you know, growing up, it's cliche to say it was raised right, but I have tremendous respect for these people, and I'm a fan, but I also acknowledge that they're people, you know, and it was a bit nerve-wracking to go meet someone of his stature in the industry, but I remember talking to my Uncle Paul the night before, and my Uncle Paul just, he had a great, easy way about him, and he told me, it's always stuck with me, he goes, just, this is so cliche uncle stuff, but he's so perfect for it. And he goes, just remember, Dave, he puts his pants on one leg at a time, just like everybody else. And I thought, that is some Western Pennsylvania wisdom right there. Like,
that's uncle wisdom.
It's so true. Yeah. And it really actually helps, because, you know, we are just all people at the end of the day. And I was really dedicated to, like, yes, I'm a fan, but I wanted to work at this, and I wanted to be really good, and I wanted to learn. I think that was the key between George and I, is that I really wanted to learn, and he had a lot to teach. I wasn't a person that was really, that had done anything career-wise. I had worked on several things, and I was really proud of it, but it was, you know, Mike and Brian created Airbender. They had done the notable thing. You know, I think I contributed in a good way, but it wasn't like, you know, the show was fantastic whether I was there or not, and I tried to work hard wherever I was and do a great job. But as far as who I was as a creator, director, writer, none of that had really happened yet. Mm-hmm. And so George was able to take my willingness to learn and instruct me in all the ways that he thought Star Wars should be done. And I was soaking it up, you know, and trying to, each time we did an episode, it was like an exam. You know, and then I would show him what I'd learned and with my team, and then he would criticize that and fix it or tell me how to improve it, and then the next one and the next one. So Jason Tucker, my editor, and I were just really focused on trying to make a cut of an episode that he couldn't mess with, you know. And the first time that probably happened, and George will always mess with stuff, by the way, it's like it's almost impossible to make it impervious.
Sorry, I can't not laugh at that.
It's only impervious if he doesn't have time.
And even then,
but he's a genius at it. There's no doubt about it. And it's the episode where Plo Koon gets trapped in an escape pod with his clones, and Ahsoka believes she can find him. And that episode, which was one of the first episodes that I did a lot of like my own substantial writing on, and combined the writing that he had been teaching me with the directing, that he watched it, and then he at the end of it, he was like, this is better because every shot has a purpose. And so he was getting me to focus in on why I'm telling the story the way I'm telling it, and as a director, how you need to kind of get the actors and the dialogue to all kind of all that working simultaneously. Mm-hmm. And because I came onto Clone Wars with no ambition of really writing anything. And it turned out that, like, probably in the vast majority of it, I write the most on all of it. And I worked later in season 3 with some fantastic writers. You know, Charles Murray, Matt Mikdavitz, Christian Taylor, all just, you know, fantastic guys that I learned a lot from working with those writers and listening to them and their thoughts. And then I was able to take those things and catapult them. Brent Friedman, another one. Just really taking what Georgia taught me and then their experience as writers and combining it into, I think that you see the episodes get significantly better in the 3rd season, mm-hmm. I believe, in the 4th and the 5th and 6th. And, you know, you just kind of learn Georgia's style by then and how he works with writers and what those guys bring to the table, which is fantastic. So, you know, it became a great group effort of people that by you know, by 2012, we had been working for many, many years together, not just me and the writers, but me and the whole production team, Athena, Joel, Keith, Paul, Killian, you know. There was nothing that we couldn't do on that show. There was no challenge that was too big for us to tackle. So that was a great time that we've still, you know, capitalized on to this day as far as how we make Rebels and what makes a show like that, I think, better than it would have been otherwise without the Clone Wars George experience.
George is just a really interesting guy. Yeah. I think a lot of people misunderstand him.
Okay.
A lot of people don't get his humor. Was there anything about him that really surprised you?
Because,
like, coming into it, it's like you have this idea of what you're walking into. Like, was there anything about the job or the experience of coming into Lucasfilm that...
I mean, his sense of humor probably surprised me because it's so good. And in some ways, I would argue, similar to mine for the way we like to pick on people. And it's just funny to do. And so I always
understood. You're quite good at it.
I understood it, though. You know, it's an admiration. You know, it's a... The more you pick on someone, the more you like them in that way, you know. And maybe we had that in common. But, you know, at first it was incredibly intimidating. And I think he knew he was intimidating. So he milked that for what it was worth on Henry Gilroy and I. But, you know, he respects hard work. Mm-hmm. And he respects creativity. And he wants to foster that and make that happen. And so, you know, we were always trying to surprise him and inspire him and make the episodes better than he thought they could be. And you know, that was but yeah, surprising. I don't know, I mean, he's George Lucas. Sometimes what's surprising is just how normal a guy he could be.
Yeah,
you know, compared to a lot of other people in his position, I think would have thought Star Wars was this greater than everything thing. And he never acted that way. He was never afraid to take chances with it. He was never afraid to challenge what the norm was with it. He would, you know, be experimental in a way that, you know, I think kept the franchise really exciting and new. So that's the maverick kind of thing that he always was. And that's what I learned the most, was that when we were the most like Star Wars in Clone Wars, when we were doing the things that was the least like anything you'd seen before. That's like with Ahsoka, her on the run and all that really felt like Star Wars because it was about her and her character and development and how it was meeting with Anakin. And those were some of the best things we did.
You've had a lasting influence on the company, I think, and like how they've been operating. Like, what's like your goal in that? Like, what do you hope
my goal
to leave as your like legacy here?
I don't know. I really don't think about that. I just try to tell
compelling
stories. I mean, that's my goal, and make each one better than the last one. You know, it's an interesting responsibility that you wind up in, and there's a certain reality component to the job, which is that, you know, it's not I'm just responsible for telling these stories, but I'm responsible for the employment of a large group of people that are working on what I'm doing. And I take that really seriously. So a lot of time is spent making sure that we're telling worthwhile things, that the show will be good, because a lot hangs in the balance. I've spent a lot of time at Lucasfilm and trying to understand the entire ecosystem that we have, from the PR department to the marketing, the licensing, what you guys do here. I mean, it's all actually very important to me, and I think everybody's contributing. So I want Lucasfilm to always be what I dreamed it to be. Which I think it is. It's this great place where these great stories and characters and technologies all come together and have the opportunity to flourish. And, you know, from your John Knowles and your Bill Georges and your Dennis Murins and everybody that's been here throughout the years, your Mary Franklins, your Lynn Hales, you know, your Steve Sansweets. There have been so many people that have contributed in a big way. And I knew so many of their names before I got here. Mm-hmm. I knew who Lynn Hale was before I started working here because I knew Lucasfilm.
Right.
You don't know, you know, you don't not know Lynn Hale and what her importance was to the company if you're interested in working at Lucasfilm. At least I didn't. John Knoll, I mean, his contributions and technology are astounding, yeah. You know, and these people are in the hallways, they're walking around, and they're incredibly pleasant to talk to. So
it's still really, like, I've been here for 3 years, and it's like, yeah. Still, like, I see John Noel in the hall, I'm like, oh my God. Or like I see Dennis Mirren in the hall, I'm like, oh my God.
It's fun and it's inspiring, you know. Ben Burtt and Matt Wood, you know, I went up at Skywalker, I talked to them. And so it's just a range of things. And I feel a responsibility to not just maintain, but help be a part of what pushes it all forward, mm-hmm. you know, and keeps it viable and exciting for future storytellers. And Kathy's really leading that charge, which is great to have her here. So that's, she's, but just about every movie I like, she's produced. So it's kind of mind blowing.
And you are doing that. Like, you are able to, like, carry on what you have imagined as Lucasfilm, I think, very well. And one of the most recent things was the reintroduction of Thrawn back into, you know, the canon storytelling, you know, mm-hmm. pool. That was something that doing the social for Star Wars for years, I saw a huge demand for. People wanted, yeah, of all sure. of the Legends storylines that they wanted to continue, that was the one that I saw the most of. And you did it. I wasn't in the room at Celebration, but I was out on our stage. And people absolutely lose it was, yeah, like, I teared up. Like, it was so touching. How do you approach bringing something like that in and giving people what they have been begging for and what you think and what they'll love without it being just fan service?
Well, it comes up because it's important to the story. And so it's not fan service at its inception point. You know that having Thrawn would be a good idea. And like I said, Kiri Hart and I really liked the character and were thinking of a way to include him from the first season. But it had to be special and have its own space. And we had to figure out how he would fit in. And we don't want to defeat him every week. And there's a lot of important things to input. I mean, it's a funny thing. Having been here a while and actually telling Star Wars stories, I'm in a very odd, unique position, which is that there's this notion that everything changed and when everything became Legends. And I can see why people think that. But, you know, having worked with George, I can tell you that it was always very clear, and he made it very clear, that the films and the TV shows were the only thing that he considered canon. That was it. Mm-hmm. So everything else was a world of fun ideas, exciting characters, great possibilities. But the EU was created to explore all those things. And I know, and I fully respect people's opinion about it, that some of the material said the next canon part of it, okay, but like from the filmmaking world that I was brought into, the TV series, the films were it. Mm-hmm. They were set in stone. So it was not a big change for me when everyone was saying everything's Legend status now. I'm like, yeah, that's what I've always understood. It's all Legend status. What I've been able to do on Clone Wars is the same thing that George was doing in the prequels, which is, you know, George liked Ayla Sakura. Ayla Sakura gets pulled out of the comic books, and now she's walking in the Jedi Temple. You know, in Clone Wars, there were several things from the expanded universe that, you know, hey, we need a gang. We need another kind of mafia group, not just the Hutts. Okay, Black Sun. What about Black Sun? Let's look at that. That exists. And I've always leaned towards if we're going to create something, we should check and see if it existed already to the fans, because it has way more value if we bring that in. And right. It's like, why would I just replace it with something new? So if we're going to do an admiral, if we're going to do a big military leader, yeah, I could create a new guy, sure. But what about Thrawn? Thrawn is great. Thrawn is a character we all know. Thrawn has a lot of credibility. So then you ask yourself, is it right to use him? And can we use him in a way that's similar to the books? Or are we using him and it's going to go completely into left field? And there have been times when we wanted to use things from the EU, and I was like, yeah, but we can't use it that way. So why? I don't want to use it and change it. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to use it and make it something completely different. That's rude. So, you know, I'm hopeful that our Thrawn hits the right notes, and, you know, Tim seemed to enjoy it, and we sent him the scripts for him to check out, and if there's something that he really didn't like, you know, I'd really think about that and decide what to do, because I want to make sure that he's happy. I figure if he's happy, the fans are happy. You always know you can't please everybody.
This is true.
So that's just a fact. But, you know, I agonized over The Voice for many, many months. The casting of Thrawn's voice was the hardest voice casting we've ever done.
How'd you come across Lars? Was it because of Mads, or was it completely independent?
You know, it was crazy. We went through so many different things. The standard line I had was that he couldn't be British because all of the Imperials have an English accent, and Thrawn had to be unique.
Well, he's alien, too.
And, yeah, he's alien. He can't have, like, a typical deep voice. Vader owns that. We've done a bunch of those. So, you know, I was looking for an accent and a flavoring that I thought would work. And so you just start, you know, you start watching all kinds of television. You're listening for uniqueness. And it occurred to us, I forget, we were watching an actor in an interview. And it wasn't Lars. We were watching somebody else. And I was like, wow, they have like a, that's a really unique accent. I didn't even know they had that. And I think that it came through that he had this particular background. And I was like, okay, get me a bunch of actors that are from this area. And I had seen Lars on Sherlock Holmes. Mm-hmm. So when his name came up as a possibility, I was like, oh, I remember this guy. And he has this kind of cool delivery where nothing seems to bother him. And he's seems very in control. And those things are very important for Thrawn. Thrawn right. is in control.
Right.
Thrawn does not get flustered. Thrawn does not need to raise his voice. He is methodical. He is precise. He has thought of the variables. He has studied you. So, you know, that was kind of what led us to Lars. And he's just so thrilled. Like, I love it when you cast somebody, then you get them on the line or you work with them, and they're very excited to be a part of Star Wars. And he was very excited to be a part of Star Wars. And it's completely bizarre because in between takes, Lars is the most smiling, friendly, happy person. And then he's completely cold and calculating. And you're just like, oh, it's weird, man.
Did you have him in the studio with the rest of the cast? Like, because you guys recorded.
No, I never have because we record him remotely.
Okay.
He's in Europe. And he'd freak him out anyway. I don't know that they could handle it.
It's a lot of energy.
But now we have two Mikkelsons, which is always exciting. And I just don't know if Lars really understood Thrawn as far as how big a character he was. Mm-hmm. I kept telling him, this is going to be a big deal. Thrawn is a big deal. And he's like, that's awesome, man. I can't wait. And I'm like, but I don't think you would have to have read the books at the time. And so I'm sure he's thrilled. And I think it's going well. You'll see it's a long game with Thrawn, which I think is good. It's a very unique way we've told a villain this year.
I've been lucky enough to be in the booth while you're directing the cast of
Is
Rebels.
That lucky?
Yeah, it's so...
Is that cool?
It's like
I
like,
hope it's fun.
No,
I don't know.
It's like one of the coolest things
oh, cool. Come that down like, anytime. I've ever gotten it's to fine.
Like, it's so cool and it's so inspiring. And I think one of the things that really impresses me was watching your grasp of human emotion and your ability to direct people into exactly where they need to be. Is that a skill that you've had innately, or is that something that like you've had to study and like work on over time?
Definitely as far as like voice tracking, and in a lot of ways, the animation directors don't always do the voice directing on TV series, but it was really important to George that I did. But the early skills that I learned voice directing came from a friend of mine named Andrea Romano, who is just a legendary director, voice director down in LA, and she is just fantastic. So for the early episodes of Clone Wars, I would sit there with her and watch her direct and do her thing and notice how she would kind of, you know, move the actors in a way and kind of help shape their performance. So I took a lot of that experience, which I'm always grateful for, from her, and then kind of combined it with a lot of things I learned from George. But I think in a lot of ways you have to ultimately just be a people person, and you have to understand as you talk to your actors what their safe zone is and what their limitations are and find their comfort zone, because you then need to decide, am I going to push that because I know I can get something if I make them uncomfortable? Is that going to help the performance? You also have to be very attuned to, I always think, like, when they're over it. Actors have kind of a limit where they do a bunch of takes and then
they're just
over it and they flatline. And if that happens, you can continue to push them and then get them through it and maybe get something great. But it is a relationship, you know, and you're always kind of balancing what you want that's perfect versus what they're offering. And my attitude has always been that I've invited them to be a part of this. You know, they are going to be the characters. So my expectation is for them to bring a big portion of that to the character and show me, like, I know what I thought Kanan was going to be when I drew him and his attitude.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't know Freddie at the time. And when Freddie walked in the studio and did his, you know, line read for his tryout for Kanan, I was like, look at this guy. This guy, like, immediately with Freddie, I was like, this guy gets it. He knows Star Wars. He's got the swagger.
And he knows your whole film background. Like, he gets right. your thought process.
So then I take a lot of what he's giving and I start to put that into, okay, so now we're going to write the character like this. And this is the things that Freddie reacts to. And every time I work with them, I kind of build to my understanding of who they are. So, like, if I have, like, some really, like, Tia's had some really, really, really important stuff to do lately. Some very emotional things to deal with Sabine and her character. And so I will talk to her, like, weeks in advance and say, this is the stuff I need you to do. I want you to think about it. How do you feel, like, about the room? Do you want people in there? Do you want to read off of someone? You know, I make it a collaborative thing mm-hmm. so that they feel very involved, that they have ownership of the character, but then that I can guide them to their best effort. Like, directing, right? A lot of people will take that, especially when they're young, and say directing is about, I'm going to get what I want finally. So I'm going to direct you to be what I want you to be.
Mm-hmm.
But I've taken the tact more that's like, directing is I'm guiding the flow of everything, from the story to the designs to the look of things to the lighting to the animation. My hand will become more forced if it's not going the way I want, but I am also so open to getting the best out of everybody. So my style of directing is more, I'm going to explain this as clearly as I can, and then Andy, I want you to give me the greatest version of that understanding that you can. I want to be surprised by what you bring back, because I go, wow, not only is that what I was talking about, it's the best version of that that I could get. Like, I didn't see all the possibilities. And if you can get open to that when you're directing, you're now open up to a better, greater creative experience. You're not limited by mm-hmm. a singular vision. Everything has a singular vision, and we're all making the same movie. We're all making the same story. But what's the best that everybody has to offer in that? And don't be threatened by that. It's not your idea. It's all of our idea. It's all one whole story. That's what we're making. And George used to talk about that, like with Indiana Jones, right? He had this idea, but Lawrence Kasdan wrote a phenomenal script. Steven Spielberg shot an amazing film. Like, every layer of it, John Williams' music was so impressive. Every layer of it got better and better and better and better. So the idea you have in the beginning is just the inception point. So what you have at the end is the greatest expression of this possible. And that's what I want every episode to be. So everybody's doing their best work and everybody's happy because they're involved. And the only way that I fail as a director and the only way that the crew will fail is if I haven't clearly explained what the story is, why we're telling this, why you're performing it. So as an actor, any question you have, I should be able to answer. Mm-hmm. I should be able to get you directed back to, why are we telling the story? Why is Hera experiencing this? Why is Zeb think that? You have to have the answers. You have to know. If you don't know the answer, if you don't know what the story is about, then you should not be at the helm. You know, you just it just can't happen, because everyone's going to get lost. People are going to start doing their own independent things. It becomes a competitive thing and a bunch of straws in the drink, and mm-hmm. nobody knows what the point of the whole thing is, and it's completely fallen apart.
The range of human emotion and how it gets mm-hmm. expressed, like, in these lines that are very short and can be considered kind of throwaways, like, that's yeah. a really difficult thing to capture, I think.
Well, the secret to being a really good director.
Yeah.
Is to have a really good actor.
Oh, you have, there you go.
I mean, very honest. I mean, and the cast is so good, and I'm so spoiled by them all from Clone Wars on out through Rebels that, like, they know the characters. We've all worked on it together, so I just have to get them sometimes to go a little bit farther than they think because I know the situation because we've already shot it. Mm-hmm. And they have to trust me that it's going to be great, you know, when I push them a little bit farther. But they're all so good anymore. I mean, Freddy, Vanessa, Tia, Steve, Taylor, they're all just incredible and do a great job. So it makes those sessions really, really, really easy. Mm-hmm. I love when we have the big emotional stuff to get through. Because they can get to it. Not everybody can, and they can definitely get to it. So.
I was there for the day that you did the Ahsoka Anakin.
Oh, yeah.
I was there, and I was just in the back. Me and Tracy and Matt Martin in the back, like, oh, God. Like, that's, like, some powerful stuff. Like, that's...
I love it, yeah. I love when the people start to cry. It's funny.
Yeah,
it's
really you do it all
Eckstein
the time.
Eckstein and Lanter. Well, and Matt Lanter and I could really plan that out. You know, I'd call and be like, we're going to really get Ashley today. It's going to be difficult just for her, so just be ready for that.
I love making people cry.
For the right reasons, hopeful crying, joyful crying, crying that is expressed of happiness, that this went the right way. Tears of joy and wonder are fine things, you know. You know, why not? I don't mind, but... you know, we'll see. I think we're going in a really great place in Rebels, and it's a huge team effort. So I have been lucky to be here at this time with so many talented people. And, you know, we have this show. We didn't have this before at Lucasfilm.
And
so this is really exciting.
I do want to take a second to thank you so much for, like, supporting our little team and what we do.
Of course. My
so
gosh.
Much.
Well, you guys report on the show. Of course I have to.
And we
love
it.
I can't make this all night. I mean, what would I be?
Awesome. Well, Dave, we are so super excited to get back into Rebels this fall. I'm really looking forward to it. There's a lot to pick up on.
This is a big season.
Yeah.
The trailer is only ever, like, you know, the first part of it, too. So for people to react so well to the first half.
They have no idea.
Yeah, because the second half is always better. We always get on a roll, so... It's going to be interesting to see what people think. That's my favorite part. Hard for me to remember where they're at. You haven't even started season 3 yet.
Right, because you're working so far ahead.
You're so behind. It's unreal. I don't even know what to tell you. Gosh.
Well, thanks for coming across the hallway. And
yeah, you guys have been better lately, but I forget you were gone. So that's why it's been so quiet.
Yeah.
You wouldn't think you'd be so loud in here. I don't know, but you change all this
we
stuff
like
all the time.
We like to have fun. You know,
All right, Star Wars show.
Thank
Is that
you so
it?
Much. For
Try to edit this down. Only use the good parts. So it'll be about a 5-minute interview. Try to
Thanks,
cut it
Dave.
Down.
Thank
if you need some help with that, I'll help out.
It's always, always, always a pleasure talking to you.
Is it?
It is. All even right. though it goes like 3 times longer than you plan.
Well, I'm a talker. I'm Italian. What do you want?
It's awesome.
My background.
So stick around. There will be more Star Wars show in just a minute.
More? You said it was too long already.
Well, we're going to cut you down.
Oh, shit.